Hello, my name is Barry Goldspiel, and I will be talking about FDA approval considerations, new endpoints, metastasis-free survival for the Principles of Clinical Pharmacology course. I have no disclosures. The objectives of my lecture are to review key concepts from Dr. Kluetz's presentation and then introduce a new clinical trial endpoint, metastasis-free survival, using some of the concepts from Dr. Kluetz's presentation. The oncology endpoints for clinical trials are a good example of how the FDA uses other than overall survival as an endpoint. Dr. Kluetz reviewed response rate, progression-free survival, symptom-related events, and overall survival as possible endpoints. The ultimate endpoint is overall survival, and the other endpoints are surrogates for overall survival, and surrogate markers depend on whether or not they predict for overall survival in terms of whether a drug can be approved. The strongest of endpoints for oncology trials is overall survival. Any endpoint other than overall survival either measures how a patient feels, functions, or survives, which are referred to as direct measures, or a surrogate endpoint, which predicts clinical benefit and ultimately results in overall survival if it's a good surrogate marker. Often, surrogate markers are radiographic or other imaging findings, particularly used in cancer clinical trials, and it depends on the accuracy, timing, and magnitude of changes as to whether a surrogate endpoint is a good predictor of overall survival. I refer you to several FDA guidances that have been published on clinical trial design over the last 2 years. The FDA has really made a concerted effort to change the way they look at oncology clinical trials and hasten the approval of oncology drugs where approval is warranted. If we look at clinical trial endpoints and the types of study designs, the randomized study design is the best for any trial. In some cases, you may not need to do a randomized trial if you're using a surrogate endpoint under the accelerated approval pathway. If the endpoint in an accelerated approval pathway drug has to be confirmed in a later trial that is often randomized. A few years ago, investigators dealing with prostate cancer found that metastasis-free survival may be a good surrogate endpoint for clinical trials. And why did they think that they needed a different endpoint? For non-metastatic prostate cancer, there's a very long survival period. That would mean clinical trials would have to go for a long time, 5, 6, 7, 8 years or more, to reach the endpoint. That would make the availability of potential medications delayed. There's also many drugs that have been approved for various stages of prostate cancer, mostly late stage prostate cancer, that have been moved up to early stage prostate cancer, thus making the availability of drugs more so for early stage prostate cancer, and therefore doing a comparison of new drugs to the old drugs makes the trials more complicated. Metastasis-free survival is defined as the time from randomization to confirmed evidence of distant metastases on imaging or death from any cause. Several investigators have shown that progression to detectable metastatic disease is a clinically relevant event that often results in pain, illness, and/or intervention in prostate cancer. There have been several studies that have looked at the correlation between metastasis-free survival and overall survival. This is an example of one of the studies that looked at 24 trials with over 12,000 participants at the patient level, there was a 0.91 correlation. And if you look at the Kaplan-Meier curve shown in this diagram, there's almost complete overlap between metastasis-free survival in the yellow line and overall survival in the blue line. Now, is metastasis-free survival perfect for predicting overall survival? No. And when the FDA decided to use or investigate this in clinical trials, one of the important factors besides overall survival is whether or not metastasis-free survival showed a substantial difference between non-intervention or placebo. There have been three trials in non-metastatic castrate-resistant prostate cancer using androgen receptor blockers with metastasis-free survival as the primary endpoint. Remember, this is a surrogate endpoint. However, for all of these trials, another concept that Dr. Kluetz reviewed is these drugs were not approved under accelerated approval. They were given full approval, which means that no further trials need to be completed. The first drug that was approved was apalutamide in the PROSPER trial, and I will define these acronyms in the next slide. That trial used several secondary and exploratory endpoints to confirm whether metastasis-free survival is a good surrogate endpoint. Enzalutamide in the SPARTAN trial also used metastasis-free survival as the primary endpoint and several secondary endpoints. And the latest, which is not yet approved, but most likely will be soon, darolutamide in the ARAMIS trial. In these cases, to predict metastasis-free survival, radiography was performed every 16 weeks. And as I mentioned, because radiology is often used and is the important measure of metastasis-free survival, the assessment of the radiographic events was done both locally and also independently. Patients on these trials also received a gonadotropin-releasing hormone analog with the androgen receptor blocker. The trial acronyms, and this is an important point that for any drug to be approved, you have to have a catchy acronym, often created from some of the words of either the type of mechanism of action of drug or the trial. So apalutamide, which is the SPARTAN trial, selective prostate androgen receptor targeting with ARN-509, which was the number of the drug when it was first in clinical trials. Enzalutamide was the PROSPER trial, and darolutamide was the ARAMIS trial, androgen receptor agent for metastasis-free survival. Sometimes I think they think more about the acronym than the trial design. Here's the results of the three trials. Shown on the gold or brown bars is a placebo arm, and the blue bar are the drug treatment arm. All of these trials were done as a 2-to-1 randomization, which they often do when you expect the intervention to have significant benefit. And if you look at the difference between metastasis-free survival, each of these trials was about 22 to 24 months difference in favor of the medication. And the FDA believed that 22 or 24 months, almost 2 years, was a significant difference between the drug and the placebo to approve them. If we look at the adverse effects seen in the trials, which is important because whenever you approve a drug, it's a risk-benefit determination, that the adverse effects are many that you can predict for when you take androgens away from male patients. And each of the drugs has their own unique set of adverse effects. In particular, enzalutamide has several cardiovascular effects. And this was interesting because the patients were excluded from this trial if they had any predetermined cardiovascular abnormalities. Darolutamide, the main adverse effect was fatigue. So if you look at the indications, these are pretty broad indications. Apalutamide, treatment of patients with non-metastatic castrate-resistant prostate cancer, enzalutamide treatment of patients with castrate-resistant prostate cancer. So that has several indications beyond the non-metastatic setting. And darolutamide, its approval is pending by priority review. To review what priority review means from Dr. Kluetz's presentation, this is a designation by the FDA for a medication where it is predicted to have significant benefit either in terms of efficacy or improved safety. The difference is 6 months versus a 10-month review time. So in conclusion, metastasis-free survival has been established as a new endpoint in trials for non-metastatic castrate-resistant prostate cancer, which means from a trial design standpoint that you need an active control arm in the trial. Placebo is probably not ethically acceptable at this point. And whether metastasis-free survival for other malignancies is uncertain. Remember, surrogate endpoints have to be evaluated in context of the disease and in some cases the stage to make sure it is an appropriate surrogate endpoint that would ultimately predict survival. Thank you for listening to this lecture for the Principles of Clinical Pharmacology course.